nobody in the room. That's an interesting setup. Good morning. Welcome to the summit. And welcome to this session about the science of happiness and what could this science could bring to OpenStack. You are quite spread all over the room. It's interesting. We will start with something really, really simple. What is it? It's a smile. It shows us either two things, my drawing skills are really great, or our brain is really interesting to recognize things. We will try an experiment. Are you OK to try an experiment with me?
Yep.
That's great. You will find a partner. OK, now, you will stand up. You will find a partner. If you didn't find a partner now, raise your hand so someone can join. OK, you will stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up, everybody. So face to face with your partner. OK, if you don't have a partner, raise your hand. You don't have a partner yet. No, no, please, come on, join. You will be. It's really not painful. You will be. You don't have? There's someone without a partner there? Yep. Someone else? Another hand? No, no, come on, come on, come on. There's someone there, just over there. OK, that's great. Face to face, maintain eye contact, and you try to have the biggest smile that you can. Maintain eye contact and do the biggest smile you can. You can see the example. You have really the biggest one. Maintain eye contact. It's really important. The biggest smile. Really, really, really? OK, what is happening? Ah, that's great. Please sit down. We can start. You've just demonstrated something that is really interesting, and we will see how it works. And obviously, happiness is something that is really well defined. And there's a lot of people who work on happiness for a long time, really long time. And the interesting thing in the US, it's even the, you know what it is? Yes, for people in the US, it's probably obvious. And the interesting thing is the pursuit of happiness is in this really nice declaration. And it's really something that's tricked me for a long time, because in the declaration, the same declaration in France, maybe you have noticed that I have a small accent. It's from France. There's no mention of happiness at all. Even if we know that all those people who wrote those declarations were working together, there's no mention of happiness at all. And it could explain that sometimes French people are really sad. Like this morning in my room, I was in the room at the hotel, and I was thinking, why are you so sad, buddy? You are speaking at the OpenStack Summit. Six could be worse. Yeah. And speaking of happiness, the first time I tried to speak about happiness was working with some people in a company. And we were trying an experiment thinking, OK, the happiness level of the people are really tightly connected with their work, their ability to work together. So if we are not doing great as managers in this company, it will have an impact on the happiness level of people. So if we ask them how they feel, we could have great information. And the first time I worked with that, it was during a retrospective, and I asked the people, OK, how do you feel about this sprint? And I turned to the first guy in the room, and he told me, I don't do feelings. So internally, I have to admit that the first thing that came to my mind I was really mad at him. Was, okay, he broke my pattern, this son of a bitch. And I think I was really mad at him. And looking at that, okay, it's really anger, it's something that is not really comfortable, why it's happening. And in fact, I am mad at me, my need to be recognized as a great retrospective facilitator is not fulfilled. Okay. But at last, he's honest. Being honest is really one purpose of the retrospective. Trust between people inside the room is really something important, so we need to value that. So the thing I've done is to thank him for being so honest, and I asked the permission to the team to start over and to explain a little bit better why I was asking how they feel. And it was a great retrospective. Yes, trust me on that. But it leads me to think, okay, our feelings at work are something important. And when we experience some strange feelings, it's probably because our needs are not or are fulfilled. It's something interesting. So it's directly connected to our emotions. Our emotions are signals to our needs. Maybe you can help us to recognize those feelings, those emotions. You know that? You know that movie? That's people you have who have kids can recognize the movie, okay? For the others, you can have a look at this movie. It's quite interesting. The guy is in red. What is it? The woman in blue? Yes, she's really sad. The woman in green? Yeah. The man in purple. And the last one? Yeah. It's really easy. The interesting thing is, sometimes we experience some emotions and we are not able to say what is it. We know that there's something happening because maybe our back is really a bit tense, sorry. Or we have some weird thing in the there. It's not happening. But we don't really know what it is. We need to stop to understand what kind of emotion is there now. And it's difficult to detect and to understand what are the emotions if you don't have the words to define those emotions. So that's also one interesting thing to learn. You need to learn the words to understand how you feel. That's an interesting thing to read literature, or not only technical docs, even if you want to contribute to the OpenStack docs. So our emotions are a signal that one of our needs is not really fulfilled. It's something important to cover. So that's why happiness is directly connected with our ability to work together. Why being happy? There's all scientific study that are backing that. You would say, okay, this one was not necessarily needed. This one is really strange, being physically healthier. Happy people live longer. It's all scientific studies on a long time. And it's really something that is weird. Obviously, being more productive can interest some companies. That's probably why there's so many people that are speaking about happiness at work. And maybe it's not a good idea to speak about this, but it could be interesting. They have more money for some people that are interested in money. It can be useful. They are more cooperative. For the OpenStack project is something that is really interesting. They are less on the win or lose system. They are more cooperative. They are better leaders and negotiators. That's interesting. That's cool if you want to be elected. They have more social support, richer network of friends, more sociable, flexibility and ingenuity to solve problems. They are more energetic, more resilient. If we look at that, maybe we know that it could be interesting to see the things in a different way. But now the problem is, what makes us happy? And obviously, we all know what makes us happy, right? Yeah. Obviously, it's a new car. I have to admit that if you want to offer me this car, I will be really happy. And you know that because I can assure that my happiness level will be really rising, really. It will be really. So it's worthwhile. Please. The problem with that is my happiness level will probably go back again to its original level. A few hours, days, weeks, months after. For marriage, for example, some studies show that it's only between 1 year and a half and 2 years. That could explain some things. That could explain that we need to do something else. It's not only the marriage by itself, it's probably something else in the relationship. And our happiness level is going back to a set point that we'll all have. And some people say that this set point is around 50% of our happiness level. And the external factors, the circumstances, like this new Tesla, would count for 10%. That's important. And the 40% that are left are intentional activities, things that we are doing on purpose. That will have an impact on our happiness level. So, what can we do inside the OpenStack project? The first thing I can see is being positive. I know that there's a lot of people that are speaking about the positive psychology and so on, so probably you're already aware of this, and you probably already experiment those kind of things. One of the writers of one book I will recommend later was doing a lot of conferences into universities and schools about happiness, and he found a nice trick to connect directly to the audience. Because as it was schools or university, he asked the same question again and again at the beginning of the conference about, do you like to do your homework when you're back at home? And usually the people were, oh, no. So that was, yes, he can say, oh, I'm like you. We are really the same kind of people. And one day he was in a school in South Africa, and he asked this same question on who likes to do their homework, and all the children raised their hand. And he thought, oh, there's something different there. Because all those children were thinking that it was a privilege to have the opportunity to go to school and to have some time to do their homework. So they didn't see the things exactly in the same way. And obviously, when you use Google to look at really important information about how the people see the things, you can see that there's quite 8 million results there for half-empty glass. And you can see that there's 62 million results, people looking for half-full glass. It's nearly the same picture. And it's really a way of seeing the world. And the way we are seeing the things will change the reality. And our own environment will change the reality. So if you are in a really negative environment, you will have a lot of troubles to think. And it's scientific-backed studies. If you put someone in a really negative environment, giving only negative feedbacks, you will prevent him to do anything. At the opposite, if you are in a really positive environment, it will foster your creativity and energy. So your behavior has the real big impact on others. So maybe that behind the change on Gerrit or behind the mail on the mailing list, we can see that there's things that we can do to change a little bit the way the things are going in our day-to-day work. So bringing some optimism onto the table could be something that is really interesting. And in meetings, or in person or online, the way you will behave will have an enormous impact on the others, on their ability to think, their ability to do things, on your ability to do things, or your ability to think. So that's something that is really simple, to build on the talents of the team, to really build great things. If you want to have more picture like this, you can look at the work of Akanforth. He's doing things with Lego to explain all the agile things that I really like, so you can foster your ability to contribute. There's also some other things that you can do about writing things about what is your best possible self, how you can be, what is the best contributor, what is the best open source contributor that you can be. Things like that. And you can sever all those things. Second thing is really simple, it's gratitude. And I insist it's scientific back studies that are explaining why it's so important. So saying thank you is, okay, I already do some advertisement for Akanforth, but I will go again. So saying thank you, it's sometimes something that is really useful. And the interesting thing about those scientific studies, they show that the person who benefits the most for the thank you is the one who is saying thank you. It's not necessarily the way we see the thing. So we can do that. We can do that in several forms. Obviously, I can say thank you in person. It's really good. And it's maybe not enough. It probably needs to be more specific so the person can understand why I'm saying thank you. I can write a letter. I can write an email to say thank you to someone. I can organize things like a kudos box or using KarmaBot, or I can develop an open source software to send happiness packets to some others. I've discovered that a few days ago. And it's an open source software, so you can all use it. So it's really important, and it will be really helpful. And the picture is not really working. But it was all this idea to say thank you and to collect those thoughts and those positive thoughts that you can have. Third thing is about kindness. It could be weird, but we are built to be kind as a species. You can look at the Dacher video that is referenced there. And if we want to be kind as an OpenStack contributor, what can we do? Obviously, we can ignore all the others, or we can ignore some others. Think we don't want to listen to them. It's a way to do things. Or we can do the things in a kind way. I've seen some contributors that have a template of emails or template of answers that they are just copy-pasting to answer to a Gerrit change, for example. Because this change is not respecting the basic coding standards or basic architecture definition that we have or things like that that have already been said thousands of times. But they have templates that of answers or of a way to say no to this change. And this template has links inside to the real documentation that will explain to those people. Because they are not doing it wrong on purpose. They are doing it wrong because they are trying to do something and they don't know. So they need some guidance. So they are really kind. And it's not so difficult to have those templates ready to be able to answer to newcomers how they could do things. And it's all decided to welcome the newcomers in a kind way. And I really like this project, by the way. You can also challenge your teams, challenge your project, or challenge your company to participate to this World of Kindness Day. It's quite weird to have a World of Kindness Day, but it can be an opportunity to challenge and to say, okay, how can we really be kind? How can we really integrate kindness in our day-to-day work? This one is really easy, you can see. I'm sure you're really familiar with this. Personally, it's probably one of the difficult ones. Learning to forgive is something really, really hard. And as the gratitude is it's something that benefits the most to the one who forgive, and not to the other. The cool thing is you can also forgive to people even if you are not telling them. It can be a start. It's sometimes useful when those people are not there anymore, but it's really important. And I've seen some project or some behavior of contributors that are saying, okay, oh no, I don't read the email of those guys. Why? Oh, because two years ago, he told me that and I really did not appreciate that. Oh, okay, interesting. This one is really an interesting one. You've probably already heard about the flow, being in the flow, or you probably already experienced that. When you are working on something, you are really passionate. It can be alone or it can be with others. And the time is flying and you are really, really creative and it's really working well. You are at the same time really challenged and it's really interesting. In those moments, you are already in the present. And you are really focused on something. We need to look for those times and try to not being interrupted every time we try to do something. So we need to manage our time not to to avoid interruptions. It's quite weird because all our communication tools, all our systems are notifying us that there's something new coming. There's a new message or there's a new message on IRC and we are looking at all those things at the same time. But if we can handle or manage our schedule to have some time without interruption, it will be really better. And I've seen some teams trying to handle that as a team. To have a synchronized focus time for half an hour or for 1 hour. Time without interruptions to be really focused on something. It could be time when you are working together on something without other interruptions. This one is really easy because it's about goals and obviously the clarity of the OpenStack project helps us to have really goals that we want to reach, and it's really good goals. It's not something that we want to avoid. It's something that we want to approach, that it's really good goals, and the purpose is really clear. And we all know this. It's the mission of the OpenStack project. So we can have a look at this and say, OK, how can we connect our day-to-day work with those high-level goals? It could be, OK, simple to implement means something. I really like this one because really OpenStack is really simple to implement, so it's already nearly achieved. And it's OK. It will be OK. So we can connect this high-level goal to our day-to-day work. And maybe we need to find ways to make this really meaningful, find ways to have our contribution to these high-level goals really understandable by everybody. And it could help when you have a good idea or a new idea and you want to bring this to one project or to several projects to explain how it will achieve a high-level goal in the project. Obviously, there will be some question on this path. This one is easy. We all know how to celebrate. We probably could celebrate a little bit more, not only every 6 months, not necessarily in big gathering, but also in small ones. And there's a lot of ways to celebrate. And it could be something that we can do more often. This is an obvious one for a lot of people in open source projects because it's based on the community, and the community is based on the trust between individuals. So you know that you need to socialize with others, not only to have your code merged, but and we all know that. Sometimes we have troubles to do that. We have trouble to integrate newcomers in our groups because we are comfortable with the people we already know, but it's something that we already know in open source communities. Something I was not aware of was really being human involved having a body. And the first time I experienced that, it was in Montreal. There was a guy, I've never seen him before, but I interacted a lot with him. He was really, really big. And the first thing he done when he saw me was, oh, how are you doing? And for a French guy, it's something a little bit not comfortable. We are able to kiss women on the cheeks, but not to take other people in our arms. And at the first time, it was not so comfortable, but it was so kind, and so that, okay, there was really something happening there. So being human, it can be something useful for us. And as happiness, as a whole, it's something that people are saying for a long time. So when we say eat well, rest, don't overcommit, that's probably because there's a body that we all have and we need to take care of it. That's why some people use other techniques that not necessarily based on the spirituality of it, but the meditation, for example, is really used. And I know that some of us are really busy, so we can use also those old sayings to understand why it's so important to take some time to work on ourselves. It could be in another way. You can use your body to do really extreme things. It was a team I worked with in Montreal. The weather is really fine there, so they have this good idea to have a big run in the snow. I did not really understand why people are doing some those crazy things. But you can see that it seemed that they were really happy. And for this team, it was really something special. It really helped the team to really work better together. So this challenge was really good for them. And we are already to the 10. And this one is, what is it? Yeah. You experienced it at the beginning. It's like a chicken and egg problem. Who starts? Are you smiling because the other is smiling? Or is he smiling because you are smiling? So maybe if we change a little bit our attitude, if we change a little bit our way of saying things or doing things, maybe it will have a strong impact on others. So maybe it's the first step we can do. And we have a whole week to smile to others and to interact in other ways. And it could bring a lot of value to the OpenStack project. Thank you. We could have some questions if you want to use the mic. Yes, please. Can you take the mic, please?
I just want to know what your background is, so okay. Where you get this information or why this is important to you.
Okay. So as you can see, it's a question. So as it's an interesting question. It's a bit challenging. Who I am to speak about this? I can take this that way. And now you can say, oh, I'm a little bit challenged. And I can say, okay, if I look at this question like this, being really challenged by someone in the audience, I can answer really badly on this. Oh, I can see that really, oh, there's someone who is interested in what I'm doing and what I've done before. Why I'm speaking about this, it's really great. It's a really nice question. Thanks for asking that. And it's all just me and those stories be inside my head. So, I am an engineer, mechanical engineer. I fall into software by accident a long time ago. And at some point, I worked with people and organizations to improve the way they were working. I worked around Agile and things like that. And at this time, I understood that it was not only technical things or process things, it was really people things. And I needed to understand how this was really working. So I followed some courses around happiness. I read some books around happiness and all this science to understand all those soft skills that could help people. But at the beginning, I had really a technical background with no soft skill at all. Something else?
Yes, hi. So I came a little bit late to your session, but a really good session, I mean, from what I saw. And apart from like what I do daily, I practice yoga and I actually teach yoga. So a lot of the things that you mentioned, like intention and goal-driven, is very important. So what kind of examples would you give if, let's say, you work at a very traditional company where everything is always the same tradition? People just go, I understand we're there to get a job done and we want to just jump into the meetings, and I tend to do that too. But I also find that it's very important to set an intention and to have people be a little bit more relaxed and open up and think outside the box. So can you give examples of type of sessions or how you would encourage someone to break tradition and to be a little bit more open and have people think a little bit more outside the box and be more intentional and be open to change? Like some simple examples of activities or how to start a session or even a meeting.
Thank you for that question. There's a lot of facilitation techniques that will help people to stop what they were doing before the meeting and start doing something in this meeting. And so we really need to break the what they were doing, so they can think about something else, and they can all focus on the same thing. So you need to start meetings, especially meetings that when you need people to really work together, with an icebreaker. Icebreaker, there's a lot of examples, there's a lot of things you can do. even the smile exercise that we've done at the beginning is one example of saying, okay, we will start to think about something else. And you need to incorporate this in your day-to-day work. And at some point, you need people to explain how the things are. And let them explain how the things are. I have an example in a 2 days workshop. We spent the first half day to let people explain how the things were. Because we really needed them to think about how they could be. But it was really important to spend all those time to let them explain how it was, because they were all thinking it's impossible to do this in another way. But when they were able to explain how it was, after that, when we erase all the boards, saying, okay, now we are in dreamland, they could see the things in another way. Did that answer the question?
Yeah, icebreaker, I get that. And probably even having like a session outside of your normal location that you meet, right? It could be in a non-conventional place, or it could be even a park, you have a walking meeting, or
yeah, it's like that. The walking meeting things is really interesting. Mm-hmm. Getting outdoor and have a walk for some time to discuss things, it's really, really powerful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I think we are out of time. I would like just to give you a small... No, I will not be able to do that. So you will see in the slides that there's things that I can recommend about movies or books or... I can do that. And you will see the reference of those books and slide in the slides. It's a small website that gives you some insight about this. And there's really people that are trying to put actions on the table to have a better world. And you can also follow this course on EDX. And that's all. Thank you very much. And please give feedback. Use Twitter, use Gmail, use whatever you want, or give me feedback in person. I will be there all week.